Some friends and I were talking a couple days ago around the dinner table. There's a group of pastors, and we said, have you ever noticed that a lot of times in today's day and age, that when people come to church, we have to get them unsaved before we get them saved? What we were meaning by that is because it seems like there is this unwritten code in American culture that if you do good, if you think good, if you don't do anything bad, you are a Christian. You've probably talked to people that say they're a Christian, and then a couple days later, or maybe even the same conversation, you've heard something come from their mouth that just kind of made your eyes open big, and you kind of chuckled, saying, well, I guess you're not the type of Christian that I thought you were. See, because American culture and biblical Christianity have become very blurry, that if you just do good, you're saved. Jesus said, I believe it was in Matthew chapter 7, that many are going to say to him, Lord, Lord. In other words, they're going to call him Lord and Master. And, you know, they're going to say how much they love him and all this stuff. And he's going to say, well, I don't know you, even though you call me Lord. Then the conversation goes on to where Jesus said that they're going to say, well, I did all these Christian things in your name, all these good things that Christian people do in your name. And Jesus said, I'm still going to say, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, is what the King James Version says. Other translation says lawlessness. The reality today is just because you do good doesn't mean you're saved. Just because you do right things doesn't mean you have righteousness inside of you. And my sermon this past Sunday was titled this, Good People Need Saved Too. In other words, a lot of times the church, all you hear us preach about or teach about is how sinners, drug addicts, people who abuse their families in a multiple different type of ways, how they need saved, or how the criminals need delivered, and all this stuff. And that's true, but a lot of times you don't hear us talk about just the good everyday people need saved too. You see, good people need saved just like bad people need saved. And the beautiful thing about Calvary and the cross is that Jesus's blood was shed for not just bad people, but it was shed for all people. Scripture says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Not just bad people, but everyone, myself included. I need you to tell me about my sermon this past Sunday morning.
Hold on. Let me think about it.
Do you remember what Pastor Trent preached about?
You know, I've slept like twice since then, right? Two times. And maybe a couple of naps here and there.
Maybe I'm recapping the sermon today, not for YouTube, but for Pastor Kayla.
Okay, hold on. Let me think about it. You passed out those invite cards.
I passed out? Yes, I did. Because we're trying to reach good people.
Yes, you passed out those cards.
I just gave you a really good hint. A really good hint.
Okay, but you always do your intro like when I'm trying to get settled.
But I preach after you're settled too. She leads worship, so she's like clearing off the stage and all that, getting a drink of water, doing all that diva stuff.
I don't know what you preached. I'm so sorry.
Paul wrote in Ephesians that we're saved by grace through faith, not by our own works, because if we were saved by our own works, we would become prideful and boast about it. But we're saved by the grace of Jesus Christ. So the lines of Christianity, of true biblical Christianity, and then cultural Christians are blurred. Kind of like they were in Jesus's day, because the Pharisees, they knew all the law, all the Hebrew law, every good thing that God had commanded the Hebrews to do. The children of Israel, they knew all of that. They lived by the letter of the law, but they lacked the spirit of the law. And the Pharisees would get mad at Jesus because he would heal someone on the Sabbath. So in today's culture, we don't like pride. We don't like the pride that the Pharisees had. But oftentimes we possess the same pride, just on the opposite side of the road. Because the pathway of pride is two ways. It can be legalism. It can be like the Pharisees in the Bible. Well, if you don't do what the law says, you're saved. Or it could be the pride that cultural Christians today have. Well, I'm just saved because of what I do. I'm just saved because, well, I just think good and I do good.
Woo! I remember all that now. Okay. There's no easy way to do that, is there? Okay, so we just went into Sam's. Our fall fest at our church is this weekend, so we are running errands for that. And now we're headed to lunch at our local taco spot. Oh God, it's amazing.
So good. La Palma. La Palma. So if you're ever in Conroe and you like legit tacos,
authentic,
street tacos.
Authentic tacos.
Authentic. I'm sorry, not legit. You need to go to La Palma. So the title of my message was Good People Need Saved Too. But the main point of my message was that we need to reach good people. But oftentimes it's challenging to reach good people because good people are often cultural Christians. And it's hard to reach people and to get people who admire Jesus but don't worship him. It's really hard to get those people to understand that they need to do more than admire Jesus, that they need to do more than just be in agreement with his philosophies on helping the poor and helping the widows and children who are in need. We must move beyond agreeing to obedience. And so that was the overall theme of the message. And then I closed with just a couple points of what we can do, like, I guess, how we can take action. What's the takeaway action point of the sermon? Number one was pray. Pray first. We should pray first regardless, not just when it comes to reaching good people and how I can reach them, but in every area of our life. The first thing we need to do is pray. If you're making a decision, before you seek godly counsel, before you talk to friends and family or get professional help, pray first. Number two is you need to draw people close to you. You can never reach people and witness to people who you don't draw close to. And before you start thumping your Bible, before we start inviting people to church, we have to build a genuine, authentic relationship with them because we care for them. Not because we want to bring them to church, not because we want to indoctrinate them, but because we genuinely love and care for people. People can see through somebody just wanting to bring you to church, or you just wanting to bring someone to church. They can see through all that. But if they feel your love, people, more than anything, they just want a place to belong and they want to make a difference. And so if we give people a place to belong in our life, and then we bring them to church and our churches give them a place to belong, they will soon follow in obeying the commands of God's word and surrendering their heart to Jesus. repenting of their sins, being baptized in Jesus' name, and then being filled with the gift of the Holy Spirit. So, but it all starts with giving someone a place to belong. And so after we love people and care for people, the third thing we do is we then invite them to church. We say, hey, come meet my new friends. Or you tell your new friend, hey, come meet my friends at church. Come see what my church is about. And then because you've already developed a relationship with them, you have the trust equity to where they will come to church with you. That's all I got, Pastor Kayla. That's the sermon recap.
That was a dramatic. And he says, I'm dramatic.
She's very dramatic. Hey, I want to thank you for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, why don't you click the like button? If you're not a subscriber, why don't you subscribe to my YouTube channel and hit the bell notification button next to the subscription button? That will help you be notified whenever I post new videos. Once again, thanks for watching. Have a good day.